Hare Krishna, welcome. This is an impromptu seminar, but so as you have no idea what's going to happen, well, neither have I. So we'll see where it goes. Okay, I had an idea. It's not a new idea. It's something I discuss from time to time, and I recently talked about it, so I remembered it. So I thought that we could speak about why accepting Krishna and not anyone else. There are so many God concepts in the world, and why would we accept a God in the first place? It's very nice, you grow up in India, and from when you're small, your parents are pushing you to go to the pranami and put something, and they want you to get blessings from sadhus, which you don't want. And many people in India, when they grow up, become staunch atheists nowadays, just because there is an element of force in the tradition. And we do things because it's always been like that, because it was under social pressure and so on. And part of that we even carry with us in Krishna consciousness, because how do we truly know that Krishna exists? What if there is no Krishna? How do we know it anyway? How can anybody know? Have you seen him? And even if you saw him, did you see a doctor as well? So, like that, we may wonder, how do we know actually that Krishna is God? And it's a good question to ask, because we are here in this temple, it's sort of part of it, and we do all these things, but why? So, Prabhupada, before giving scriptural arguments, would use arguments of logic, because after all, scripture means you have already accepted. You're accepting that scripture is an authority. So why would you accept that as an authority even? On what basis? So one who is not just accepting that Krishna is the Supreme Lord will also not accept because the Bhagavad Gita says so, or because another scripture says so. That will not be convincing. Logic. We can try logic. So maybe I can invite some of you to present some logical arguments for the existence of God or Krishna as the Supreme Lord. I mean, something logical. Why? Anybody got an argument? Why are you believing this? For example, you and all your friends. Why?
There's some reciprocation.
Loud.
Because there's reciprocation, and because when people say about something, I was told about something simple, then it happens. Like it was an aspect of Krishna consciousness, and then it came true in my life, and then there's no reason not believing in it higher.
Okay. So one argument is because there's reciprocation, and because then there's no need to look for anything higher.
No, that how Krishna reciprocates, and then it happens in my life, then there's no reason of not believing in higher aspects of this philosophy.
Yeah. some things happen in your life that are supernatural and therefore you accept.
So some things we can check on this earth.
I'm translating it into into three words so that everyone can sort of, okay, folks, instead of 50 words or 200 words. So what you call something that's not on this earth, in English that's called supernatural. Something beyond what you see. Yeah. Well, people said the same thing about Sai Baba. They said Baba appears in our life. Baba reciprocates. Baba does these things. And there are many people that testify that Baba came in their dreams. Baba came in their lives. And that's why they accepted Sai Baba as God.
Thank you so much.
So why are you not accepting Sai Baba as God? But he is doing all these extraordinary things. He did all this extra. He is no more on this planet now. Let's hear some more. I saw a hand there in the middle. Yeah. There was no second microphone. Let me speak loud.
It's coming.
Firstly, I want to speak about the existence of God. So creation means a creator.
Okay.
And then nothing happens by chance.
Why do you say there's a creation? Isn't that an assumption?
No, because, I mean, as far as my knowledge and understanding goes, whatever I see, I can see someone is behind it for it to be created. But everything that I see.
Yeah? The ocean, why? Why is it created by someone? Why is it not just chemical combinations that just go on forever in different varieties?
I know ocean can't be created. I mean, I haven't seen ocean being created, but
then,
I could see fountains and small lakes being created by human beings.
That may be, but does that mean that if you see some things being created, does that mean that everything has to be created?
Yes.
Why? If you see that, you know, that many things are cooked, then does all food have to be cooked? No, there's also things that are not cooked. But you can, that's also, so it's not that. Why would, if you see that some things are created, why would it mean that all things are created?
Presence of a symbiotic system, which is in which one thing is dependent on the other, and the way it's working perfectly, we can only see in the creation of somebody who's perfect. I mean, human beings, irrespective of how advanced, intelligent they are, have not been able to create such a symbiotic system up until now. So there has to be a higher being which has created such a system. So first is the acceptance of that.
Is it really working perfectly?
Yeah.
There are so many natural disasters, so many, you know, starvation, deserts, and to name something, you know, many creatures, yeah, or living beings, call them that, because we will not go for creatures who won't accept any creation. But they take birth in a puddle in the rainy season. And then, at the end of the rainy season, the puddle disappears. And their whole eco-environment disappears. You call that symbiotic?
It disappears.
I call that, like, you know, it doesn't seem to be a plan behind it. They just took birth in water, and then they die, because that water evaporates in a matter of weeks.
Yeah, but then there are things which we may not know at the moment, but we're discovering day by day with our...
All right.
So we see there is a perfect order.
So you're saying there is a perfect order in the things that you don't know?
No. In water.
It sounded like that. How do you know that there's a perfect order in the things that you don't know? Yes.
The reason why having these natural disasters and, you know, these problems in this material life is because of our, our action. So for every action, there is a reaction.
How do you know?
When I do good work, I get rewarded. When I do bad work, I get punished.
Well, personally, if I steal, I get rich.
Sooner or later, you get punished.
What?
Sooner or later, you get punished as well.
Never happened so far. Everything going fine?
Because of our limitations.
Because of our limitations in our context.
We cannot control anything.
Then?
There must be a higher being that controls everything. That's the controller.
Why? We are limited, so there must be a higher being that controls a greater power than us. But maybe nature is that power. The power of nature is greater than the power of man, isn't it? Maybe it's just the laws of nature. Why there has to be a God behind it?
Because it's taken in the Bhagavad Gita.
But who wrote that? Who's the real author of that book? Do we know? I'm sorry, I'm here to make everyone confused. Yes?
I wouldn't like to offend anyone, but I think during the British reign in India, someone who was atheistic went to India and he said, having seen the chaotic state there, nobody actually abides by the rules, and yet there's some sort of, you know, things don't go that wrong, there must be some sort of God who, despite our mistakes, make things go
through. I just lost temporary. Now it's back. Okay. Just yours. It's something like the story about Birla, you know. It's a Birla joke. Birla came to heaven and they wouldn't let him in. And he said, but I did so much good work. They said, what good work did you do? He said, well, like I made many temples. He said, yeah, but you did that with your own construction companies. You deducted them from the tax and then you made the profit from your own construction companies. So actually you made money from it, that doesn't count. So they're going over the whole list, and then finally he said, I made the ambassador, and which is like India's pride and car. Then he said, I made the ambassador. Then they said, well, what's so good about the ambassador? He said, the ambassador is very good because it makes you pray. Joke, Birla joke. Yeah. So something like that you're talking about. Because although there's chaos, somehow or other, it were Indian traffic is such a thing. If you don't believe in God, just drive on the roads, and you know there must be one. Otherwise, there would be many more accidents. I've heard that argument. Well, in a court of law, something like that would be dismissed by the judge as circumstantial evidence. Right? You're talking about circumstantial evidence. There seems to be there's so much chaos, so there must be a God. But circumstantial evidence doesn't mean that it's like there's a gun in the room, there is Kudamani is also in the room. She must be the one who pulled the trigger. With her, and she has rubber gloves as well. Circumstantial evidence, but it's not really proven that you fired the bullet. You would be dismissed. You wouldn't be condemned by a court of law.
But it happens every day. It's not like it's just a one-off. You know what I mean? Like if you had a camera that actually films it every day, you would actually see...
What happens every day?
That nobody abides by the law in India. I mean, not no one. But you know what I mean? As you gave the example of the traffic yourself, like there will be a dog lying on the street and somehow three cars coming by, but they would not hit the dog.
A cow usually dogs they don't peacefully lie on the street. But cows they can do that. They can lie in cars or soothing cars. Not always. I mean, it just means they're good drivers. They can improvise. In India, everyone can improvise. But there are laws. For example, if you, the traffic is left side, you're driving to the left, but when a car comes from the other side, you pull your car to the right. Yeah? So you go in his lane, and you drive straight at him. That's the system. And then last minute you go to the left. So in this way, out of fear, he will give you room to pass. You see? Because he'll go to the side. Because if you stay on your left side, then he'll push you off the road. So there is some system to the madness.
True, but there must be someone who gives you intelligence. It's not that we learn with the school. You know what, and...
Yeah, okay, but there is a religious view to all these things in the world, and there is obviously the scientific view. You know, there are scientists like Hawkins or Dawkins, or, you know, who are all coming up with arguments that everything is simply developing biologically. And they get better at it all the time, at manipulating genetically and so on. They get more refined in these things. So,
but you get also bigger side effects that impact on everybody.
Yeah, but we're up against something. We're up against Richard Dawkins. Do you think that your argument will be sufficient to defeat Richard Dawkins?
Well, but his argument isn't coming to me either.
Good. So then you have two. You have the believer and the non-believer, each in their corner.
Yes, Muridhar has got.
Okay, Muridhar is rolling up his sleeves. And now it gets serious. Aye.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Logically, one cannot prove the existence of God. Neither can one prove the non-existence of God. So ultimately, there is no escape from fate. So that is the first point that I want to make about the proof of existence of God cannot be done logically. Neither can it be denied that there exists a God. But I think there are. If you take the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita, that's a nice starting point for the proof of the existence of a substance beyond matter, and which is consciousness, and that can be the starting point for the proof of the existence of God. The existence of consciousness is a very strong evidence of the existence of something which is not visible with the material senses, and that can be a starting point for convincing anybody.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So,
if we cannot logically prove that God exists, and also not logically prove that He doesn't exist, then why are we having so much faith?
Yeah, so...
Are we not logical?
So faith is something... Yeah.
Are there logical people and not logical people? So the logical people, they can understand that you can't prove it, therefore they won't believe it. And then you have people who are not logical, it's not us.
So faith is something beyond logic. And faith is a gift to that extent that those who believe are fortunate because they have the faith. And faith is something beyond logic. And you start with faith and then logically work backwards for the existence of God. You can't start with logic and then come to faith. You start with faith and then come to logic.
The scientists say just the opposite. They say those who don't believe, they are fortunate. Because they see things as they are. And the other ones, they are sort of living in their own preconceived illusion.
Yeah. Because if there is no... Even the scientists, for example, they also use the word God, but they don't call it God, they call it chance. So there is only two things, either you believe in chance or you believe in God.
Mm-hmm.
So those who believe in chance are the scientists.
Mm-hmm.
And those who believe in God are the person who has the faith.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it ultimately boils down to, another word for God is chance.
That's a nice one. Another word for God is chance. I appreciate it. I knew you would say something. Of course. Yeah, but so if you start to play with definitions, because it's not just a matter of names. If you play with definitions, yeah, then you can make everything God. But generally speaking, most scriptures of the world are seeing God as like an all-powerful, all-knowing being that is the source of everything, the maintainer of everything, the controller of everything. And when we say chance, is basically, there are philosophers like Aristotle, right, who said that matter is eternal, and that has continued, right, throughout the ages, again and again. Philosophers have said matter, it's not created, there is no beginning, so it doesn't come about by chance or anything like that. It's just eternal, and it's just preservation of energy. It's just changing. The energy is simply changing. That's all it is. So therefore, they say there's the whole idea. Why is there a need for origin in the first place? So if there's no origin, then it doesn't come about by chance nor by God. So what about that? Matter is eternal. That solves that problem.
That's a nice point, but
boy,
it's off.
So. Yeah, it should stay on. We should turn it off.
It's a nice point, but then we again, in fact, we again believing that matter is eternal. How do you prove that matter is eternal?
Fine.
On the other side, we can prove that something exists now which seems to be not very random, which seems to be very clear. We have, if you were sitting in a house, we have an earth, we have a functioning solar system, so things that are maybe not eternal, but that definitely exist on a, well, seemingly intelligent basis. So then we can, I don't think that there is no logical point to having at least something with intelligence, because, you know, if I go outside and I see a car already, or the famous example, I walk through the forest and I find a watch, right, I wouldn't, which is completely functioning, my mind wouldn't argue that someone created it, much more I would say it was created, not just it fell from a tree by chance or something like that. If I find a functioning model, obviously there is some intelligence behind it. Like there is a famous story of Newton when he was around with one of his scientist friends, and they were watching the sky, and then Newton was glorifying the sky, and the friend made some comment that it's all by chance, and later on Newton invited his friend for lunch. And he came over for lunch, and there was a perfect model of the solar system on his table. And the friend would say, "Oh, beautiful model, where did that come along?" And you would say, "Oh, what do you mean where it came along? It was already there." "Yeah, but who built it? Who put it there?" "Oh, no one built it, it was just there." So if you see something in this world that was created, no one would come with the idea that it doesn't have intelligence behind it. But when you look at the brilliant universe, we think, "Oh, that came by chance, by some eternal matter." I think that's much more faith required in that than considering some intelligence.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay, that's nice. That's a bit of a circular argument, you know. It's not really... I didn't say matter is eternal. Neither do I say, I just try to show that the polarization between saying there must be a creator or chance, and chance, in a way they accept chance as God, it's like I just offered another option, and just saw, the chance option is also still open, right? God option may also be open, but there is hardly any evidence for it. So I think, you know, Muralidhar was right on that point. You know, like no matter how you turn it, you repeated the same argument that somewhere, I'm not sure who, but someone on that side earlier on was also presented, the design argument, but you made it a little more graphic and a little more developed. So yeah, the design argument is one of those arguments that are brought up. So when we start arguing on the existence of God or not, then we can argue for a long time, and it goes back and forth, and no one will exhaust his arguments, although still people have faith, right? Absolutely. Well, it's because we base things on what you call, one approach of logic. There are different approaches of logic, and I'd like to, someone brought up the point of consistency, yeah, consistency. So, and it's also a little bit in what you're saying. If you see something in a micro model, then you think you would see it in a large model also, consistency. Fine. Bhagavad Gita also uses such kind of evidence. One famous verse, Deinu Shmin Yata Deyahe Komaram Yodanam Jada Tata Deyantrapati Deez Tata Namunyati. In the Bhagavad Gita, it says that as you go from childhood, boyhood, youth, old age, similarly, at the time of death, the soul enters into another body. Why? You know, if you look at it, that's not evidence, right? You go from childhood to youth, that's not evidence. But, so Bhagavad Gita is not trying to offer that kind of logic, you know, that kind of hard empiric evidence. Bhagavatam is reasoning in another, or the Bhagavad Gita is reasoning in another way. It is reasoning in the way of consistency. Yeah? It's saying there's a consistency. So consistency, if you see that things, bodies are changing throughout our life, then why not also after the life? Yeah? And the more such, so it's more based on indication. Yeah? It gives us an indication. And to me that seems to be more the basis of our faith than anything else. Indication. You've heard it before from me, maybe. We accept things on the basis of indication. Yeah. And if we look at if there is a God, you can give any definition to God. Like I was in New York, I met God on a park bench. He revealed himself to me. I waited for all these years, and then I met God. He was 64 years old, there was a tooth missing, but that was his position. And at that time, God revealed to me that he was God, so I told him, that is wonderful. I am your devotee. And all these years I have dedicated to you only, to no one else. And now, after all these years, I'm meeting you here on a park bench. You look a little different than I imagined you would look. I always thought when I would meet you that you would look a little different. But I must admit, you are all-powerful, you can take any form you like. So, alright, if this is the form you've taken, show it to me, that's very nice. But I must admit, although I'm faithful, I have some doubt in my heart. So my humble prayer is, could you please clear that doubt? So, yes, I can. What would you want? Said, like, well, could you maybe make those trees on the other side a little taller so that the sun, that they have a little more shade because it's getting a little hot? Is that, what makes you think that God can do that? I said, like, well, isn't God all-powerful? Can't he, like, you know, do anything? He said, that's your definition of God. I said then, what is your definition of God? That he's a powerless, old, toothless old man? Then anybody can be God. So, generally speaking, you can make anything of God you want, and the more you reduce his powers, then anybody can be God. But commonly, in most traditions, God is accepted as all-powerful, all-knowing, timeless, ageless, beyond matter, not affected, right? Eternal, in other words. So yeah, I'm not saying they go outside the realm of faith, but we have a concept of a God who has no limitation, who's not limited by anything. He's unlimited in all respects. If God was limited, then the question is, what is the limiting factor? What limits him? He said, well, he's limited by time. Then you get a competition between God and time. Then time becomes more powerful than God. So that's, see, if you limit him by time, so there's like a problem. If you limit him by intelligence, then you put intelligence above him. There's a greater force than him. So that poses a logic problem. Therefore, it's quite logic, if there is a God, that he would be unlimited. That would be, and also eternal, that he would be eternal. That's logical. So we are looking at, if he's unlimited, he would also be all-knowing. If he is unlimited, he would be all-powerful. He would be, he would have all qualities. So that his qualities would be unlimited. So in Krishna consciousness, we find that definition, that unlimited personality, which makes sense, that there's no competition with anything that is greater than him. So that is one argument for God, if there's a God, that he must be unlimited. Maybe we don't start with the question, is there a God or is there no God? We table that. But we just say, if there is a God, what should he be like? And as we explore that, he's unlimited. Then we find all these qualities in Krishna. We can begin to explore Krishna. Since we're dealing several of you have brought up a logic which is saying that what we see in this world tells us something about the next. Well, that argument is also found in Bhagavatam, in the 11th canto. There's a Brahmana who has many teachers in this world. He is seeing an arrow maker, he is seeing a... it's like the arrow maker is making an arrow, trying to make the perfectly straight arrow. And just that day, there was the emperor came through the city, and there was a whole parade, and it came right through the street where the arrow maker was. And the arrow maker later was asked, did you see the parade? He said, parade? Parade? What parade? I mean, what do you mean, what parade? It came right through the street, right past your workshop. Because I didn't see anything. The noise was deafening. There were bands playing. I didn't hear anything. Because he was completely absorbed in making a straight arrow. So that point is made in the Bhagavatam about how we see things in the material world that are part of a spiritual reality. That in the spiritual reality, as Bhagavad Gita says, vyavasyatmika buddhir, one becomes one-pointed, ekatmana, savai Krishna, padaravindayo, savai mana Krishna. You have to fix the mind of Krishna's lotus feet, one-pointed. We don't argue whether Krishna is God or not. That's not our entrance ticket. It's not that you have to come in the door and then we ask you, you know, I often do the Christianing, that we ask you to be a believer. Are you a believer? Actually, a devotee, when we first come, we are investigating. We're investigating. We're not saying that we buy into it. We're just investigating. And it says in investigation of a system of belief, there should be a principle of suspension of disbelief. Like, for example, sometimes I was asked to speak in some for some group of students, and they wouldn't let you even finish a sentence. And after half a sentence, they would already argue. So that is like not the proper system. If you approach some other system of belief, then the first step is suspension of disbelief. So you just put your disbelief on the shelf, so that you can investigate the belief. This is what we ask people. All right, you don't believe, you don't have to believe in Krishna, but he could be God. So for now, you know, come and check it out. And that's actually the first step in the door, suspension of disbelief. And then the next stage, we begin to explore. We begin to explore the qualities of Krishna. And then we see Krishna is a person. So again, it is said, like, if you everywhere see personality in the creation, then, or in this world, then if there is a God behind it, then how could there be no personality in him? Here is something, but that he does not have. So one can say, from that argument, you can say, like, well, he may be anything. He may be all-pervading, may have so many energies, but we cannot deny him personality, because we see personality everywhere. Every dog has a personality. Every tree has a character of its own. Just like the tree in the courtyard here must be a devotee. And some trees are demons and some trees are devotees. Yeah. Like that, it is said, pious trees. Impious trees, they have a character. So, we can understand something about Krishna from... we see that Krishna is a personality, because we see personality everywhere. So there must be personality in God. Well, all right, Krishna has it. He has personality. Yeah, but then logicians argue again, and they say there's a problem with personality, because it's limiting. That's the thing with personality. Personality is a problem. If you ascribe personality to God, you're limiting him. And we just established that, you know, you can't limit him, because then you put something above him. So there is a complication. Yeah. So then, all right, we will not limit him. We'll give him an unlimited personality. A And that's basically what we see in Krishna. So you see, like, it's by exploring Krishna, we see his personality is logical, his qualities are logical, and the more we hear about Krishna, his nature and his qualities, the more he has all the characteristics. And he's not a limited God, he is God unlimited, with unlimited beauty. Each quality in itself is unlimited. It's like, here in this world, you see something beautiful, you look at it, you kind of look at it really well, and then you sort of, you've got the limit of it. You kind of figured it out. Okay, this is as beautiful as it is. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta says, at first you look at a quality and it looks like an ocean. Then you sort of investigate it, you walk around it, and you find that it is no bigger than a pond, and you never care to see it again. So Krishna's qualities are not limited in itself. One cannot say the beauty of Krishna, that one will ever know the end to it. It's an ongoing experience. Every time again, for eternity, Krishna's beauty is stunning. It's not like if you live with a beauty queen, you know, after a while you don't see it anymore. Sometimes, but get used to it. That's how it is. It's just normal. But Krishna, every time we see the devotees are stunned. It's just, when Krishna enters, it's just a stunning experience. Overwhelming. Each time again, it's not like anything casual. So there's no routine in the spiritual world. I was reading the Bible, and I was reading how God was seated on a golden throne, and then angels dressed in white clothes, they were fanning him. I thought, like, boy, sounds boring. Forever. Of course, I don't want to diminish that either. It could be also that within that there is an eternal new experience. So grant that to the Bible as well, no problem. But the thought occurred in my mind. So this unlimited element is the basis of our logical approach towards Krishna, because then we can begin to explore the unlimited character of Krishna, and the more we do, the more we become convinced. It's just say, like, if you say God is blue, God is a blue boy, and you go like, wow, really? Are you sure? blue boy. But if I begin to explain, well, it's not blue, actually the color is sham. Like in India during the rainy season, when the sun is very bright still from the hot season, and the rain clouds come, then the bright light of the sun combined with those dark clouds gives those clouds a bluish reflection of the sky, because the light is so, and it's very effulgent, those clouds. That's sham. That is sham. So blackish, bluish, and very effulgent. Well, that already sounds like more divine, right, than blue. God is blue. So the more we explore about Krishna, the more all his qualities are consistent. They stand up as being of divine nature. Krishna's beauty is of divine nature. Krishna's strength is extraordinary. We see that he kills many demons, huge, enormous demons are defeated as if it's nothing. And Krishna is unlimitedly strong, but he doesn't have like the same muscles as the wrestlers in Kamsa's wrestling arena. Then Krishna and Balaram looked like boys, and these wrestlers were like, you know, they were strong, and they were like, you know, as if they were on steroids, huge guys, like walking gorillas, and they were much taller than Krishna and Balaram, and, you know, everyone looking in the arena was thinking, this is not a fair match. They were right. It wasn't a fair match. What chance did those tiny little wrestlers have against the Supreme Personality of Godhead? And that became very clear. Because Krishna just hit this wrestler on the head and the eyes of the wrestler just popped out and were dangling like that. Well, so just the strength of the Supreme Lord was not depending on muscle. That's the point. It was not like on the size of the muscle, you know, like we judge strength according to the size of the muscle. The guy with an arms like that, okay, you know, all right. All right, you look at him sort of like, okay, don't upset him. These arms are a little too big, yeah. We don't want him to use the arms, but Krishna didn't need such arms. His arms are, you know, not like bodybuilders' arms, they're like elegant and beautiful, yet unlimitedly strong. So in this way, there is logic to Krishna. It's not that he's like illogical, he's very logical. He has all the quality, all the attributes that God logically should have. Yeah. Krishna is all-knowing, And that is there, you know. Sometimes Narayan was seated there, smiling, and Lakshmi was inquiring, why are you smiling? I'm smiling because of my devotee. And that is the nature of Narayan. He's all-knowing. After all, Krishna is in the heart of all living beings. He knows everyone's thoughts. God is all-knowing. He knows everyone's thoughts. Yes. So Krishna perfectly fits the bill. You can't ever point out that Krishna does not have divine qualities each time again, or that his behavior is not divine. And in that way, Krishna is very logical. And in this way, by hearing about Krishna, we automatically begin to become convinced. Yeah, like who else, you know? Who else is that powerful? Like Michael Jackson. Yeah? Michael Jackson was made of plastic. He was made of plastic. Was not real. He tried to look young, but many operations. Each time, that his skin was going like that. When you get old, right? For those who don't know yet, when you get old, the skin gets loose and it starts to hang. And that's why you get so many wrinkles. So then what they do, they pull it back. See, I can also do it, you know, 10 years ago. Yes. Sew it up, yeah. Beautiful. Face lift, it's called. Yeah? A few places, a few other lifts, yeah. Everywhere it stays. Pull it back up. Yeah. And, you know, you can go again, yeah, on the outside. But inside, you know, old, finished, yeah, it's just disguise. So Michael Jackson, therefore, was made of plastic surgery, a plastic man. But Krishna is young. Really young, always fresh, never affected. So therefore, if we simply are exploring the life of Krishna, the qualities of Krishna, then we see that he logically has all the attributes that God, that are to be ascribed to God. In this way, if there is a God, and so we hear, we have the atheist, you know, so well, it's stuck on the question, is there a God or is there no God? Shall we argue about this point? And we just say, yeah, that's fine. that this, we have some arguments. We have some arguments. You know, like, one argument is this, is that it's the pragmatic argument. The pragmatic argument is that whatever judge things by the result. So if I believe that I am from biochemical origin, then you know, I just get, then what is the point of life? What's the meaning of life? What's the meaning of everything? It's just chemicals. You are chemicals, I am chemicals. What's the meaning of anything? What's the meaning of morality? If I believe that I'm of biochemical origin, I think then I need a drink. I think so. I need a drink to just forget the misery. I'm going to die and life is pointless. And anything, if I'm of biochemical origin, then I need a drink. I think so. A whole bottle maybe. I think so. To forget it. It's not a happy philosophy. Look at the result. You know? Evolution. Okay. Fine, you know, we're not going to argue it today. We're just looking at like, okay, so you just came about by chance. Fine. Came all about by chance. And you're going to also, at one point, die by chance. Then, what is the meaning of life? What's the meaning? No meaning. It becomes depressing. That's why we see in modern times so much depression. A lot of depression. What's the point? What are we doing? We're working like slaves. What are we doing it all for? Or anyway, you know. So no meaning. So we have to see the consequences of an idea. And that's the pragmatic argument. Judge by the result. And then you see that, like, well, Krishna consciousness offers a positive outlook. And, you know, death, that's not a major problem. It's actually no problem at all. It's really just a change. Just a change. And there is no loss. All the devotional service that's done, so death for a devotee, there's nothing bad about it. It's only getting better. For example, yeah, so we can see a devotee can be optimistic. A devotee is something positive to look forward to. Also in the present, you know, like we have pizza and the neighbors have pizza. But our pizza is prasadam. And therefore our pizza, it tastes good. But you know, maybe the pizza next door, if it's a vegetarian one, anyway, whatever, in his eyes, it maybe also tastes good. And we say, yeah, our pizza tastes good. But that's not all. Our pizza also has an eternal dimension. With every bite, you make eternal spiritual advancements. Hey, that's, so we have the immediate pleasure and we have the long-term benefit. So even in this life, we live a better life. So if you judge it like that, then you say, like, well, you know, Krishna consciousness gives you the better life. Others may say, yeah, but, you know, there is so much enjoyment, and Hare Krishna devotees, they can't do all those things. So, you know, we are living the happy life, and the Hare Krishnas, they live, yeah, a really, really dry life. Nothing allowed. Not allowed to live, basically. What are the four regulated principles? Can be summarized in one. Not allowed to live. So, what is this? What is this? Then we are looking at... But our answer to that is like, no, it looks all sweet on the surface, but it gets you really entangled. Nothing comes alone. Nothing comes alone. Everything has a bill. Okay? Everything has a price to pay. That's the point. And, you know, and then there are more strings attached to those things as well. In the end, it's a whole network. You want a car, and God, what you, then you have to have a job for money to pay for that car, to maintain the car. You have to have a driver's license. So you know, you have to have many things. Yeah? Just because you want a car, you can't just have the car by itself. I mean, you know, there are traffic rules, and there's so many things. There's a network of complexities. If you could just have a car, that would be great. But there's like millions of things related to cars that you also have to have, and that you get involved with all the complexities. And everything is like that. A man wants a woman, and a woman wants children. Most men don't get married because they want children. They get married because they want a woman, and she wants children. And then he's like sweating, oh my God, now a child is coming, help, what's going to happen now? Men are afraid of children. And after a while, of course, they get attached, my son. That's another story. But it doesn't start out like that. It starts out with a mentality where a man wants a woman and a woman wants children. It's interesting. What can be said? Different psychology, different desire. So life is not... my point is, there are always additional things to everything in this world. So if someone makes that argument, that, oh, we have all the enjoyment of the Hare Krishnas, they live a dry life. And our answer to that is that, you know, you don't have just all the enjoyment. You have some things, you know, for your enjoyment, but look at all the strings attached to it, it's not worth it. And the fight, you have your enjoyment, but the price you pay for it, it's not worth it. One boy had the most beautiful girl in the world, hey, you're lucky. Son of a gun. Is he really? I don't know. If you have the most beautiful girl in the world, probably she's going to be one of the most demanding girls in the world also. I don't know if it's going to be so easy for you. You might find that, you know, you have to constantly prove yourself. You'll always be on your toes. Or, for you, there's 20 other guys waiting. Yes, dear, no, I understand, we need a new car. Yes, I appreciate it. Of course, yes, yeah, definitely. You want to change the furniture? Of course, we changed it last month, but we can change it again. You see, so it's not like, nothing comes in itself. There are so many things. Therefore, those who say, oh, we have all the enjoyment. No, you don't. You have a network of complications in your life. And we have our principles, we avoid some complications, that's all. Like, alright, we don't drink, well, that saves a lot of headache. I mean, you know, Sunday morning, we would probably have a headache this morning, you realize, if we would drink. We'd probably have a splitting headache right now. That's what happens. It's a Saturday night. Sunday morning. You can't just have a Saturday night. With the Saturday night comes the Sunday morning. It's like that. So this argument that they have the fun and that we are living a dry life is doesn't stand. Doesn't stand. So from a pragmatic point of view, the Hare Krishna lifestyle is better because we stay out of trouble now and have a decent life, and at the same time we get eternal benefit. So 1-0 for Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, one again. Like that, you know, there is an AIDS problem in the world. I don't know in Australia how much you are thinking about HIV, But I was just in Africa, which is like where HIV is extremely high. In fact, in South Africa, right now, the population is decreasing due to HIV death. Yeah, it's decreasing, it's going down. So many people, and it's all over. Not only the African people, but also Indian and other communities. I was just there, and on the Radhastami Kirtan, someone played mridanga, and they hit the mridanga, and suddenly his finger burst, and the blood splashed straight to my eye. Anyway, Krishna's in control. So if I get HIV, then I don't know how to go. But, so what to do? Huh? It is a big problem in the world, AIDS. What to do about it? So they, in South Africa, they had big signs at the side of the road, you know, and they had a campaign for using condoms. And it said, if you go casual, dress formal. Yeah? With the idea of avoiding these kind of diseases. Fine. But it failed. Then they had, like, a few years ago, they had a conference in Manila, an AIDS conference in Manila. And in that conference, they discussed how to control the AIDS, the growth of AIDS in the world. And finally, they said, this condom campaign, it didn't work. It didn't work. People didn't take to it. He said, the only thing that will work is abstention. That was the conclusion. From abstention. Yeah, but how do you get people to abstain from sex life? It's not so easy. Easier said than done. There's only one way. If you offer them a spiritual process. 2-0 for Hare Krishna. And again, Hare Krishna scored again. There were several ecological conferences about the future of the world. And I don't know if you've seen some of these ecological posters. I saw like a poster which showed, you know, like you can, when you have a cheese, the cheese comes like sometimes in a big round wheel, and they cut like a piece out of it, and it looks like a point, right? Like that. So there was a poster, and the earth looked like a point like that, you know, just one point. And then on there was a beautiful house with a nice picket fence and garden and everything. And under it said, home sweet home. And sort of showing how we're slowly destroying the world, and we still live on top of it, home sweet home, in our nice, lovely little house. And meanwhile, most of the earth already fell off. And okay, that's sort of what the poster is saying. So, yes, why is this going on? Well, because of exploitation. What do I care? You know, I built the factory, I pollute. I saw a country named India. We're talking today about India. And it's like in India, a simple village somewhere where people were dependent on the river. That was their water. Basically, they were taking bath in the river, they were washing the pots in the river. Meanwhile, a new factory had been opened, and it was only like a few kilometers away, and they were pumping all the chemical waste into the river. And the villagers had been living there forever, long before the factory, and they're taking their water. And people were getting sick. And there was a television program where the director of the company said, it's totally ridiculous, these arguments that, you know, the chemicals in the water, you know, are causing problems to the villagers. That is absolutely ridiculous. And then he said, and I'll, you know, and just to show you, you know, he had a glass of water. He said, here I have a glass of river water. And he put his fingers in there, held them in there, put them out. See? No problem. Too much. Paka. Charles Robbins. What can you say? Translation means cheated, paka cheater. That's incredible. So, it's the fact, it's the selfishness of people that leads to this ecological disaster. So, the conclusion of the ecological conference, a worldwide conference, was that the only way that we can motivate people to give up this selfishness is a spiritual solution. That's the only option. And Hare Krishna scores again, 3-0. Right? We're going to win the match if we go on like this. So, on a material plane, there are definitely serious arguments in favor of the lifestyle. So the pragmatic argument stands very strong. After all, one must say that we speak about physical health and mental health. So, mental health, it means that we must be happy. Okay? If somebody is not happy, then they are, they start to develop symptoms of being mentally unhealthy. Depressed, aggressive, this issue, that issue, get mental health issues. And it's all related to unhappiness. Yes. It's like, somehow or other this morning I was remembering that an unhappy experience in my life before Krishna consciousness, when I had a girlfriend, and she just went with my I came to the house, and she was there with my best friend, and they both said, "We don't need you here tonight. You can go." And I was like, "What?" You know, they betrayed me. And next moment I was on the street. And then, because I was so disturbed about that, I kicked over a garbage can. Right? I was mentally disturbed. And within 3 minutes, the police was there. And they got arrested and put in jail. And meanwhile, I was thinking, and meanwhile, my best friend, while I'm sitting here in jail, my best friend is now with my girlfriend. Those things were sort of made me a little bit materially exhausted. The material world's not always so easy, so sweet. So we see that the principles of Krishna consciousness, where lust is controlled, make sense. It makes sense. Yeah. Where we make commitments and say, okay, one partner. Yeah. That makes sense. And then a process next to it that helps to control us. So, okay, I wanted to just show you a little bit that on a pragmatic level, the Krishna conscious way of life gives us a better situation now. And it gives us a better situation in the future. Okay, now we started with a little argument. Now I did some talking. And there's a microphone lying next to Johnny for your feedback. So Johnny, it's your turn. You've got the mic in your hand. What are you going to do now?
If I may have two arguments.
Yeah.
You were talking about Krishna being God and having all these qualities. And what if someone comes up and says, you know, somebody invented Krishna, someone who had a great imagination, like we have the Greek mythology, and, you know, even the person who wrote Harry Potter, you know, she had a big imagination. What if it's just the fruit of an imagination Krishna is? Yeah. And the second argument was that...
Can I have one at a time? Just one. well, Different philosophers say something about that. Like, for example, Pascal, who is like saying a lot in favor of God, he said, like, if God didn't exist, we would have to invent him. In other words, you're basically saying here someone invented Krishna, and he has all the qualities that are really wonderful. Right? Therefore, someone would say, if God didn't exist, we would have to invent him. We'd have to invent some personality that is just wonderful. And we're seeing that indeed the materialists who are denying the existence of Krishna, they have to invent their own mythology, something. Right? Superman, Spider-Man, Something Man, right? But we have Hanuman, yeah? And he is like much more far out than Superman, and he has a noble nature also. So one might say that Krishna is the product of someone's fertile imagination, but we say again. But each of these qualities of Krishna are responding exactly to something, to a need in us. So then we go to the psychological argument. We need beauty. You know what I mean? Every human being has a sense of aesthetics. And every human being, you know, likes beauty. We like it. You know, we want everything. Yeah? Clothes in front of the mirror. Why do we have a mirror in the first place? Beauty, huh? Beauty. We like beauty. Beautiful places. Everyone likes beauty. I mean, even people who are like trying to create something ugly, like, you know, in some punk or some, people try to sometimes make it ugly. But even then, there's an aesthetic sense in it. You know, it's just like something. There's a beauty in the system by which they present the ugliness. So beauty is something that we have a relationship with. Strength, strength impresses, right? See, always some girl falls on some guy with like big muscles, you know. Muscle matters. Right? Muscle, strength. We're looking for strength. Everyone. It needs strength. We find shelter in a strong person, mentally strong, strength. Krishna has all these opulences that we are looking for. So that's a psychological argument. See, on the psychological argument, you can say like this. There was thirst, and lo and behold, there was water. There was hunger, and lo and behold, there was food. Yeah? And there was a need for oxygen, and there was air. So like this, whenever we have a need, there is something to answer that need. And then suddenly there's a religious need, and that's your imagination. No, the very fact. Like Nietzsche argues this point and said that man has created God. God has not created man, but man has created God. So that he would feel some shelter. Yeah. That's why he had to create God. So, we need water, we need food, and we need shelter in some superior being. So, each time when there's a need, there's an answer. But when it comes to God, there's no answer. There is no God, that's just your imagination. So this argument can be defeated. Yeah. Next.
The second argument was on the point of depression. You were saying how materialistic people suffer from depression and they're not happy. But it's not that all devotees are always happy and that there's no depressed people in our community.
Yeah, no, that's definitely true. But you know, someone made that statement and said that spiritual life may be difficult, but material life is impossible. Yeah? And there's something to say for that. That in the material world, you cannot find any constant happiness. Therefore, we have to constantly ask every day. It's the most normal thing in the world when you see someone to ask, how are you? So that proves the point, that you don't have constant happiness. Otherwise, you don't have to constantly ask, how are you? 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 You can see, there's the potential for trouble is definitely there. Otherwise, if everyone was always happy, you wouldn't have to ask, how are you? So that is the issue. We are materially, therefore, sometimes happy, sometimes not happy. So devotees, same thing, materially sometimes happy, sometimes not happy. But the more devotees get absorbed in serving Krishna, and when that becomes the main thing, then they're always happy. You can do a historical study of saints. The Catholic Church has its saints, Muslims have their saints, everybody has their saints. Mauritius must have some saints. Even in Holland we have some saints, believe it or not.
Australia's got saints as well.
Australian saints.
I actually think you're their football club.
Yes. And Australia has gurus as well. Kangaroos. Yeah. So Australia is also in the race, no problem. We're okay. So now, Australia, right? The saints, that's what it wasn't in Australia, so you distracted me. Good job. Saints. Saints are people that are known to have an inner happiness which doesn't depend on the external circumstances. And that's across the border, cross-cultural saints are like that. They're satisfied within themselves, not dependent on the externals. And where do they get that satisfaction? From their connection with God. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Maharaj. Very interesting topic today. Just want to add, when once somebody asked Prabhupada, you are wasting so much time in this movement, what if in the end you found that Krishna is not God? So to answer that fellow, Prabhupada said, we don't care whether Krishna is God or not, we're just enjoying, we're feasting, dancing, chanting, still we are having a good time. And what if in the end you found out that Krishna was God, so you were anyway loser in both circumstances?
Right.
And on my own opinion, I want to say something. I choose Krishna consciousness or...
Okay, but you're doing the same. She did. You're doing two things. So can you wait one second? I can respond to one and then you take two. Otherwise, Plato has the same argument. Plato is speaking, Socrates is speaking in Plato's writing, and Socrates is saying if there's two options. One is there is life after death. The other option, there's no life after death. He said, if there's no life after death, then I have nothing to worry about, right? I have nothing to do. But if there is life after death and I didn't prepare for it, then I would find that I'm in trouble. So better I prepare for it. Yeah? So it's the same argument Prabhupada gave. You can also see it in confirming in Plato, which is useful to know because that makes it stronger. That makes Prabhupada's argument even stronger, because in a Western philosophy like Plato makes the same point.
And second argument, once when somebody asked Prabhupada, you're saying that there's a soul and there's a super soul, the supreme personality. Prabhupada said that, okay, if you believe that everything came by chance, or by chemicals, I'll give you chemicals, you produce life from it, and we'll agree that you are right.
Yeah, 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 Prabhupada liked that, to chant. He called it post-dated check, they'll make life in the future, and so on. Can they make an egg? Things like that, Prabhupada, many times. Yeah, so that way we can challenge, because they'll argue back. When we start to argue on the existence of God, Muralidhara's point is true, that that, you know, ultimately we cannot prove it, although we can prove that those who believe in God have a better quality of life. That we can easily prove. And that's an argument on our side. They may not say that's not absolute proof, but it's definitely putting weight on our side, and that we can do. But my point was, we're not going to waste our time with this question, does he exist or does he not exist? We're simply going to explore different concepts of God. And the more we explore Krishna and Krishna consciousness, the more it makes sense. Like Prabhupada, for example, said that the universal form is also God. In the 11th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, there's this huge form, many mouths, many hands, many mouths, many eyes, many faces. And then all the heroes of the battlefield are disappearing in the mouth of this huge personality, and they all just are chewed up like potato chips. So this is a little intense. This 11th chapter of the Gita is intense, if you think of it. But of course we see it happen in real life, because everybody dies, and we see how time is really, ultimately, generation after generation dies. So you can see that it's true, but it's sort of ghastly. Prabhupada says, yes, this form of the Supreme Lord, as universal form, as time, the destroyer of worlds, this form is also God, but he's not lovable. It's not a lovable form of God. This is a fearsome form. So, but in the form of Krishna, Arjuna wanted to see Krishna. Arjuna realized Krishna is my personal friend. You know, I can sit with him, play with him, joke with him, and yet he is the Supreme Lord. So this element that of all the manifestations of God, Krishna is unique, because there is no deity. Yesterday, Sarumati with great expertise, as if she has practiced for many, many years, said, Allah! Maybe his neighbor was a Muslim or something. That was good. That was really like... So what can be said, you know, Allah Akbar. But he is definitely Akbar, he is the greatest. Yes, all right, fine, God is great. Yes, we accept that he's great, he's behind everything. But is God also kind? Is God also human? Is he... that element Krishna has, the combination of being God and human at the same time. And that makes him very close to us. So that's something, another feature of Krishna consciousness, which makes it stand out amongst all the choices, you know. Like maybe Sarumati thought about it for a while and tried it out. And she decided, no, I'll go for Krishna consciousness. Because she understood, with Krishna, you get more close. It's not only that he's great. Like Prabhupada said, the universal form. Can you dress the universal form? Then it would take a lot of cloth. Where would you get all the cloth? But Krishna, you can dress. It's personal. You can do personal service. And, that is unique.
And lastly, Maharaj, I would like to say why got interested in Krishna. Just by hearing three characteristics of Krishna, I got very influenced. And these are one is that he saved and protected his friends who were in danger, like the Pandavas. And second is he saved and protected Draupadi, who was getting insulted. And lastly, he also, when his friend Sudama, who was very in poor condition, he came to him. He was the king, and he left out his own position and washed his friend's feet. So all these characteristics, moved my heart, but I presume it would move anyone's heart. And whether he's God or not, but one can consider that he is a very high character person. So just by knowing those things, you can have faith on him.
Mm-hmm.
At least as a good person, not even as God, but as a helping person.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So these are the factual things.
Okay, that makes Krishna attractive.
Yeah.
Yes, true.
Nice.
Yeah, let the mic go around. Around and around.
Hare Krishna.
How do you go?
Prabhupada also said, God has many names, and while there's different religions, we want to promote God consciousness. So whether you call God as Krishna or Allah or whatever it is, then you're moving in the right direction because you're believing in God. But to your argument about whether religion or God has a good impact on society and people, but by the fact that there's so many different beliefs, people also say that it causes so much trouble and so much. I guess there's so many fractions.
They say that.
Yeah. So how do we argue against that?
Yeah, I was on a plane and coming from Canada to New York, and there was a man sitting next to me, and he goes like, "I had a dream." I said, "Brother, tell me all about it." He said, "I had a dream of a world where everyone would be united, where everyone will be together." I said, "Wonderful dream, brother, wonderful, wonderful." He said, "Yes, a world without religion." So I said, "Oh." I said, like, okay. He said, "But look at me." I said, like, you know, I'm not 20 anymore. You know, I've sort of invested my whole life in this. And what else am I going to do now at this age? You know, it's like, it's difficult. You know, like at your old age, you just have invested in a certain direction, and then, yeah, you have to just carry on with it. So, what about me? Then he looked at me intensely and he said, "You are a problem." Okay. So there are indeed many people in the world who think that the world would be better off without religion. And especially, you know, like, since apparently religiously based terrorism has come up, and more people are like, you know, abhorred about, you know, the terrorism coming especially from Islam side and everywhere. I have seen in India, right, I saw there was this book from this Salman Rushdie, right, Satanic Verses, and there was one bar in a place called Makrana in Rajasthan where one Hindu was saying, actually, this book is a real good book to some Muslims. Well, the Muslims became a little bit upset, and then the Hindus overturned in revenge one Muslim car And the next thing, from the masjid, right, they came out by the hundreds with petrol and they burned down all the shops. It's a typical, some communal riots. We have seen a few of those. I also can describe a few more.
So yeah, those are
moments where you think like, what good is religion? Yeah. So the external side of religious practices and beliefs, right, can be intolerant, can be fanatic, can be expressed in wars where one group hacks into the other group and so on. But that has nothing to do with spirituality. That's just external cultural, the external cultural aspect of belief, of religion. So the external cultural aspect of religion for some people is all there is, you know. I'm a Hindu. Why? Because, I was born like that, you know. I don't follow anything. Yeah? I've never followed anything in my whole life, yeah? Ever. Nor did my father follow anything, but we are Hindu. Yeah? We smoke, we drink, we eat anything, but we are Hindu. Yeah? Because, you know, my family is Hindu. Then religion has become completely external, and there is no more spirituality. So when religion has become an empty shell, then it's only culture. It's an empty cultural shell, and it doesn't have any substance of spirituality. That's when religion can become a disturbance, actually. Yeah. And in Kali Yuga, that's in many cases. It's often the case, right, that religion has become that empty shell. Like I know a Christian girl that married a Muslim, and they said there was no problem at all, because they were anyway not following their religion. So it was fine. Right? They got on fine. It didn't make any difference. So an empty cultural shell. The beard is still there, right? Maybe even the namaz, but. And then, it's like different religions have their in their culture, they may have some fanaticism, Jesus is the only way type of approach, you know, the only way, and everything else, condemned, or, you know, Allah. Like that, this kind of fanaticism. Like I was in Dubai on the airport, peacefully minding my own business, and this Muslim from Iran comes, and he was interested, asking some nice questions, this and that. Suddenly, some sort of Taliban personality, you know, in that Taliban outfit, he stands there, he's from Pakistan, and he goes, "Can I enter the debate?" There was no debate. And within less than 30 seconds, he was on the deity, right? Why worshipping the deity? Because, you know, no idols. No idols ready to break the deities. And so, and the history of India, you know, in Vrindavan at one point, there were many deities broken. Yes. Vaishnavas were killed, a rupee per head, right? And at night they would stack up the heads. Seriously, I read about these things that happened. Yeah. So, in the name of religion, many atrocities are performed. The Inquisition has, tortured so many people. So we must therefore, Prabhupada would often say, we are not a religion. Right? We're not a religion. You can say, you know, spiritual science, spirituality, we're not a religion. A religion is a cultural shell. Right? And it must, and the essence of it must be spirituality. Right? So that's where the trouble comes in.
But then could people argue that that's a similar thing, like what you said before, where everything comes with baggage, like, you know, having a car. While it may be good that you have so much baggage, but it could, but that's what people argue as well.
Yeah, because say even in Krishna consciousness, there are people bring their baggage.
Yeah.
Therefore, we don't say that that everyone who is connected to our movement is an angel. But ultimately, our process does not condone it. We are not condoning that people are killing left and right. We're not condoning such things, even if some of our members may do anything, that doesn't make it something we agree with. Yeah. Some religions are a little more aggressive. In some religions, the Prophet himself goes out with an army. That, of course, okay, we also see that. But Krishna consciousness is not a religion. It is the original spiritual consciousness. So as soon as people try to say we're a religion, tell them, no, we're not a religion. We are speaking about what is the essence of every religion. Krishna consciousness means love of God. That is the essence of all religion. That's what it's about. It's not, we're not a religion.
Hare Krishna Guru Maharaj. Maharaj, I've got three questions if time permits.
One at a time.
Yeah, one at a time. You know, when we started the talk, you mentioned the two questions. One is there a God? And you briefly touched upon that, is Sai Baba God as well. So the argument, that topic was there initially. So there's a friend of mine who is practicing, of course, following Sai Baba and all. But when I talk to him and he says that when you say he's all-inclusive, he's all-powerful, why can't you think of Sai Baba as, or whatever he did, as a leela of Krishna only? He is an incarnation of Krishna. Why can't you think of that? So that's the first question.
Well, okay, even if for argument's sake we would accept that he was an incarnation, that's fine. But there's avatar and avatari, the Vedic literatures describe. So avatari is the source of all the avatars. So it is said that with each avatar, with each incarnation, the potency of the Supreme Lord is diminished. Yeah. So the full potency present in Krishna is only partially manifested in the avatars. Therefore, ultimately, one must turn to avatari, to Krishna, the source, the one light from which all the other lights are. That's what Vedic literature states, right? And after all, they follow Vedic literature. Because I saw a Gita produced by them, and I could see that that they had read Prabhupada's Gita, because there were some parts that were like directly Prabhupada's Gita. But whenever Prabhupada said surrender to Krishna, then he said surrender to me. Instead, they changed certain things, but some things were almost verbatim.
Yeah, well, my second question actually, it's not mine. I mean, a friend of mine who's not present here, he wanted me to ask you this. He said when Krishna came, into the world, in the Treta Yuga, who was the presiding deity at that time?
When Krishna came.
Who was the presiding deity? Krishna is the presiding deity.
No, but when Krishna had come to Dwapara Yuga, were people, was there any deity who people were, praying to or following or at that time?
Not one, many deities. Many deities. We see that
The social custom was that the gopis were engaged in worship of the Sangha, worship of Katyayani, and so on. So by the social system, they were forcing the gopis to engage in demigod worship. Then they asked the devatas for bhakti. So they were worshipping all kinds of deities at the time. This morning I had to five deities. They were all worshipped at that time. There's definitely karma kanda going on at that time, at the time of Krishna. So it's not one deity. Even in Satya Yuga, there was not like one deity. We see, even in earlier times, various deities being worshipped. Not that there is one predominant deity that's worshipped by all people.
And the last one basically I wanted to ask was, this is again a doubt somebody asked me in one of the classes, saying that whenever, most times what happens is whenever we have a lecture and all, we focus too much on criticizing impersonalists. Why is it that we do not present our case rather than talking negative about something else? Shouldn't we be focusing on the personal aspect more than focusing on criticizing impersonalism?
Mm-hmm. Well, there are three Vaishnav sports. One is swimming, another one is wrestling, and the other one is beating my advice. what to say? Mentally beating, not physically. But why is that? It is because the philosophy of impersonalism is diametrically opposed to Krishna consciousness. It is systematically undermining worship of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And unfortunately, this impersonalism has widely spread all over the world. In India, of course, you go to someone's altar and you see it looks like the Indian bus. It's very full, There's even someone hanging off the side of the bus. That's how it is. So the altar is the same, right? The altar is the same. It is so full. Everybody is there. There's almost no place. Right? This Baba, that Baba, this deity, that deity, everyone is on there. Why? Well, just in case, Just in case. You get some blessings, so put it there. Put it there. No, it might work, right? So put it there. And then, the underlying principle anyway is that these are all manifestation of the same one impersonal energy, and then you get someone who speaks out, some learned person speaks out about Hinduism, and the beauty of Hinduism is that it is the one culture in the world that has been able to absorb so many different ideas. The one culture of spirituality where different ideas can coexist next to each other. So many God concepts are there. And we're all united in the concept that ultimately it is all one. So beautiful. So this is you hear this impersonalism is obviously widely proliferated in India. In the West, just as much, the same thing, right? That impersonalism is found in Christianity. There used to be an idea that there was a personal God but then science came. And, they withdrew. They said, no, that's actually the mythology for the simple people. Actually, God is all-pervading intelligence and love. Pakamayavad. So Mayavad is everywhere. There is a history of Mayavad in India, a history of Mayavad in the West. And impersonalism has influenced all of us. One time Kirtanananda asked Prabhupada, why are you always preaching against the Mayavadis? And Prabhupada said, you're asking that question because you are a Mayavadi. Yeah. We are the Mayavadis. We have to understand them. There is a Mayavadi living in us. And so when we are defeating the Mayavadis, we're not actually fighting with some imaginary opponent, you know what I mean? A boxing match with the invisible Mayavadi. One for the Mayavadis. No, it's not that. One for the neighbors, you know, the Mayavadis. Let's criticize the Mayavadis, the neighbors. Feels good. That's not what we're doing. We're actually defeating the Mayavadi that lives in our own heart. Because we're contaminated by this Mayavadi philosophy. That is the thing. And that is why Prabhupada said his mission is to drive out impersonalism. Nivishesa Sunyava, to drive it out. We are the Mayavadi. Now someone say, wow, how can you call devotees Mayavadis? No, Prabhupada said that. The point is that this Mayavad brings the living being in competition with Krishna. So every living being came to the material world because he's in competition with Krishna, and therefore it is called the last snare of Maya. When you give up all other types of Maya, then the Maya that I am God is the ultimate sense gratification. So this tendency lives in us since we turned away from Krishna, since we are in competition with Krishna. Therefore, it is important that we cut it down. So it is actually directed to ourselves. Now it is 2 minutes to one.
Thank you very much.
It's a good time to stop. No, last term. No more mic, this is dead.
I think the speaker is disconnected.
I think the speaker is not working.
Charge
is not.
Charge. Charge.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. Again, we live in Australia. We came in touch with Krishna consciousness, following it nicely, or trying to be. But we find that when we compare Australia, which is more material well-to-do, there's a more social welfare scheme. When we go out toward the Indian audience, it's rather easy to attract them. But people outside, when you try to please them, they don't find the need. There's no need for God, for God consciousness. But as soon as we go to other countries, even if non-Indian, if there's more distressed present, it's easy to attract that. We find more genuine devotees as well. Sometimes not criticizing anyone in particular, but there's more quality of devotion coming out. Like in Russia, even though it's a considerably Western country, but still you find that you hear many inspiring examples of. So from teaching point of view, because it's supposedly less stressful conditions here, the people who are in material or jobs or business, they don't have. Say, I'm doing well anyway.
Yeah, sure. What's
it's the hard to preach.
Well, you're very right that people in the Western world, they have they also have a history with strong religion that imposes a lot on people, and they've turned away from it. So now this generation is not so directly. You cannot directly tell them to be God conscious. I was in a program and there was one Indian sannyasi, and this was actually in the Netherlands, a country also like Australia, you know. And then in the middle of the program he said, and now I want you all to fold your hands and say this prayer after me. And I was going like, oh my God, you know, these Dutch people, they will never accept this, you know, it's going to be a disaster. But they all did it. Yeah, they all did it. But generally they don't. they don't want to pray, they don't want to speak about God. So then you don't do that. Then you begin on, at the cultural level. You don't immediately have to go to the religious level. Okay? That can come after. So if you deal with people who are not ready to accept God, you present the culture. And there is a lot in the culture. A lot. There are noble qualities, right? There are moral, there ethics is there, qualities of ethics. There is a health program, Ayurveda, vegetarian diet, and so on. Yes? There is a concept, again, ethics, non-violence. There is an ecological solution, cow protection. Huh? The big thing in the ecology is energy. So, you know, like, you need to come up with an alternative energy solution. We have ox power, yes? So, cow protection offers a complete ecological answer. So you can see, I'm beginning to approach people about the wealth of our culture. And if the people, if you want to speak to Westerners, don't speak about God, don't speak about Krishna, speak about the wealth of the gods, of the culture. And suddenly they're very interesting. You know, if you talk about Ayurveda, oh, they eat out of your hand. And then later you introduce, actually, some spirituality. So it takes a little longer. Another target group that I would recommend in Australia is not only the Australians, but the Chinese. This is like a place where you should think of how to reach the Chinese. Yeah. And if we present ourselves more culturally to people in the first instance, and then later on more religiously, then we are interesting. Because we have a very rich culture. Very rich. We have Vedic architecture, we have so many things. And between China and India, there are many old connections. A lot of knowledge went from India to China in the past. But actually there are traditional connections. So the Chinese are good potential. We can preach to other communities if we present ourselves in the first instance culturally. But then we have to learn something about our Vaishnav culture. We can do. And then we find people will be very interested. All these new age teachers, you know, that make so much money, they come from India. They tell, like, they say something, Ayurveda, they say, oh, you know, you make a fortune. And then some mantra meditation. Ecological problem solved. Yeah. Tell a whole story about Vedic ecology. Oh, you're a guru. Talk about Krishna, nobody wants to know you. So the Krishna part comes after. Yeah. But we should reach out to others. If we, I'll finish now, but if we just spend our time, you know, just amongst ourselves, then we become like a social club. Right? We spend all our time with ourselves to keep ourselves in Krishna consciousness. Then we become a social club. And at one point we dry up. So we have to also do something to give knowledge to others. In book distribution, Vaisheshika in America has been very successful, mobilized California with Sankirtan Saturdays, Weekend Warriors, right? You can look on www.distributebooks.com, www.distributebooks.com. And actually, and a lot of Indians are partaking in that program. Weekend Warriors. But you can do. The books will do the work. Okay, I thank you for your time. Leave you now for a break. Can I give myself also a break? I'll see you later in the day.
Is Kadamba Kanana Swami Maharaj ki?
Jai!